So this is a GPU partner you may not have heard of before called Colorful. Yeah, it's called Colorful. This is a Chinese brand, so it's not that popular in the US market, as you may have already noticed. But more importantly, how does it perform and does it offer quality compared to the everyday brands we usually hear of, like Gigabyte, Asus, MSI, and so on? If you guys follow Nerd on Budget, he made a similar video about a week ago discussing a similar topic for another Chinese brand called Yestin. If you haven't seen that video, I highly suggest checking it out. So let's break this card down and see if Colorful is a Chinese brand you can put your money on. Also, I'm officially launching my own store with my own merchandise as usual, but also my own brand of tech art. I make all the designs by myself, so if you want to add a minimalistic yet personalized touch to your setup with PC and tech enthusiast in mind, I highly suggest checking it out. The link will be in the description below and I'll probably pin it in the comment section. What's up guys, it's JD from JDTechGear, and here are the timestamps for each section of the video in case you're here for only a specific part of the video. Otherwise, sit back and relax and enjoy the experience. The GPU market right now is in turmoil, but you can find lower tier cards like the 1050 Ti for a price that isn't grossly overpriced. They're a little overpriced, but if you absolutely need something and don't mind paying extra, these are your only options besides going onto the used market, and even that's overpaying. First, let's go over some of the basic specs and aesthetics. The GTX 1050 Ti came out a while ago, so I'm not going to go too far into depth about its specifications. The card's aesthetics fall into the black and red theme, but it's not overdone and doesn't look too aggressive. There's a matte finish on the plastic shroud showing a stealthy color profile. There's two 90mm fans with 9 blades in total. The entire card takes up 2 expansion slots. There's 1 DisplayPort, 1 HDMI, and 1 DVI port for output. On the back, you'll also notice a button. And yes, this is a button, and it's as cool as it looks. Basically, it loads a turbo profile to boost the memory and clock speed. Nothing too crazy, but enough to give you a little boost. The normal profile is 1392 megahertz and the boost profile is 1493 megahertz. Although when I was monitoring gameplay and other graphically intensive applications, the clock frequency would go up to around 1700 megahertz. There's also a metal matte coated backplate included with this card, a very nice aesthetic touch, and the design is minimal and not overly aggressive. I really like the look of this card. It's sleek and can suit multiple color themes since the red accents aren't overly done. Even the aluminum fins on the cooler are black. Overall, a nice looking card and made with relatively good build quality looking from the outside in. We'll get into the VRM a little later. For the test bench, I pretty much gave it the best chances of performing at its maximum. I've got an 8600K clocked at 5 GHz and 16 gigs of RAM clocked at 3200 MHz. For anyone that wants to ask why I'm not using the 8700K, it's because the 8600K and 8700K clocked at the same frequency is basically the same in terms of gaming performance. For all the benchmarks, the Colorful GTX 1050 Ti had the turbo profile enabled. I really like the fact that for consumers not comfortable with overclocking or any sort of boost performance, you can easily press a physical button and not have to worry about insane power draws or overheating or potentially killing your card. So in order to enable the different modes, the PC must be restarted in order for those changes to take effect. Also, I have no other GPUs on hand that relatively compare within the same price or performance tier, so I'll only be comparing the Colorful GTX 1050 Ti by itself at different settings. And the benchmarks will be going over high settings, ultra settings, and ultra settings again, but with the manual overclock to around 1911 megahertz. For my overclock setting, I was able to get a steady 1911 megahertz on the core, 7518 megahertz on the memory, with the power limit pushed to 120% and my core voltage to plus 53%. Also, for all the benchmarks, anti-aliasing is off and post filtering is set to low because honestly, they don't make much, if any, of a difference to the visuals and it can severely degrade performance. First, we have Battlefield 1 at 1080p. And the results are quite impressive. Both at high and ultra settings, we see steady frames over 60 FPS. There's occasional dips to around 55 to 57 FPS with 1% low, but the OC setting helps bring up the average FPS and the occasional frame dips. Even the 0.1% lows are close to the 1% low, showing that Battlefield 1 plays nice and smoothly with this card. Moving over to Doom, another well-optimized game, this card runs smoothly over 60 FPS at all times, even the 0.1% lows with exception to the non-OC ultra setting. Doom really likes to overclock on this card, pushing it to over 90 FPS. Needless to say, the game experience was fantastic and smooth all around. Fortnite is again another well-optimized game, unlike its brother PUBG. All game settings were well over 60 FPS, especially playing at high settings. The interesting thing here is that the overclock had a downgrade in performance from the stock turbo profile. Some games don't perform better with the overclocks, while most do, some don't, and this is an example of that. Playing at ultra settings had occasional dips to the 50s and high 40s, but it was still a very smooth gaming experience. Lastly, we have the infamous game is PUBG. Surprisingly, this card can play 1080p at the high-end settings relatively smoothly. Now, PUBG has gone through some recent optimizations and whatnot, but it's still a relatively challenging title to play smoothly. The 1% and 0.1% low speak on that behalf. At high settings, it's pretty smooth, averaging just above 60fps with the occasional dip down to 49 frames. But what this game is famously known for is those dropped frames, which is shown at the 0.1% low of 25fps. Now, it is for the most part a pretty smooth experience, even when it's dipping down to 49 frames, but the offhand 25fps dip is still present during gameplay and is pretty noticeable. Surprisingly, the ultra setting fared a bit better in terms of difference between the average 1% and 0.1% low, and the overclock definitely brought up some of those frames. Not by a huge margin, but noticeable. I recommend playing at high settings for 1080p resolution, but you can definitely get away with ultra settings if that's your preference. Overall, the gaming experience at 1080p is impressive, and the card is great for almost any title at 1080p with an average frame rate over 60. Now let's move over onto synthetics, thermal, and noise performance. First, we have Firestrike. I don't have Time Spy because it would crash on the second graphics test, completely voiding my results. So for Firestrike, we saw a graphic score of 8020 with a stock turbo profile and a score of 8634 on the OC setting. That's a pretty decent boost in performance. Superposition is next with the following results. At the stock turbo setting, I got a score of 3882, average FPS of 29, and a max temp of 60 degrees Celsius. With the overclock, it scored 4169, which is a decent jump from 3882. The average FPS was slightly better at 31.6 FPS, which really isn't much, and the max temp reached was 64°C. Lastly, we have Firmark. I only have the stock turbo profile on the graph since Firmark kept crashing with the overclock, but other applications and games ran fine with the overclock. Nevertheless, the stock turbo setting provides a good benchmark for the card. At the stock fan curve, the temperature plateaued at 68°C, which is pretty cool for this GPU melting application. The total system noise reach was 41.8 decibels, which is very, very silent. At 60% fan speed, there was only a marginal difference in noise and temperature, but at 80% fan speed, there was a more noticeable difference. 45 decibels is still relatively quiet and kept the card cool for running around 1600 to 1700 megahertz. Overall, the cooler does very well. The 1050 Ti is a cool card to begin with, but the cooler in this case is still adequate and quiet with no coil whine or significant humming or buzzing. It's also worth noting that during gameplay, the card only reached around 62°C at a stock fan curve while overclocked, so both in a synthetic and a real world scenario, this cooler does its job well. Now let's take a look at the VRM. For anyone who is new to the term VRM, it means voltage regulator module, which basically controls the power going to the GPU. Cards with good components on the VRM will tend to have better and more stable overclocking along with a longer lifespan. For a GTX 1050 Ti, you don't need a beefy VRM to overclock it. Here we have a three-phase VRM. Phases are made of several components, but essentially the more phases you have on the VRM, the better overclocking you will have. Phases basically filter the power going to the GPU. The more filtration, the cleaner and better the power delivery will be. Since this is a 1050 Ti, you won't need a bunch of phases. GTX 1080 Ti's typically have 8 to 10 phases, even though there is no true 10-phase design. You can count phases by counting the number of chokes, which are those large squares. Phases are typically comprised with a choke, capacitor, and a MOSFET. You can usually go off just counting the number of chokes. The MOSFETs are SM4377, which are rated at 50 volts and 30 amps, and operate up to 150 degrees Celsius. SM4377 MOSFETs are typically considered good quality and are found on higher-end GPUs. The capacitors are FP78UB8212s, which I couldn't find anything in specific on them, but they are a type of capacitor labeled by FP. FP capacitors are made by Nichicon. They're rated for 2,000 hours of use from -55 to 100 degrees Celsius, and from what I can tell, the VRM is made with good quality parts and should last you a long time, even with a high overclock profile. Looking at the cooler, there's two copper heat pipes that run through the nickel plate block and make contact to the die surface on the GPU. The die is that central square in the middle of the card. The heatsink is adequate for this cooler, as proven with the thermal testing results. The 1050 Ti is not a hot card to begin with, but this cooler does the job and does it quietly, with the dual 90mm fans on the shroud. In conclusion, this is a solid competitor in terms of quality and performance in the 1050 Ti bracket. GPU prices are still crazy at the time of making this, and this card is going for around $280, which is way too much. Normally it's around $180. Typically this card is a little above MSRP compared to the other brands, or at least from what I have noticed, and this may be due to the fact that the company's consumer base is primarily based in the Eastern market. Aside from that, this is a card that you can depend on and is made with good quality parts from the outside and internally. It's cool, it's quiet, you can overclock it, it has a turbo button for the core clock, it looks good without being overly aggressive, and it games well for 1080p gaming for 60fps and above that in most titles. For a Chinese card, I have no bias, but this card competes and is quality. How did the other cards in their lineup fare? I don't know. I haven't tested them out, but I would feel inclined to purchase one since I had a very good experience with this card. And sometimes I do notice that Chinese cards are more available than your typical AIB partners like MSI, Gigabyte, and so on. But you'll have to find them on Chinese-based marketplaces like GearBest. Thank you to GearBest for sending this card out. It was a pleasure to benchmark and test its value. I hope some of you find peace in this crazy PC market, and maybe this card can be of some service to that. Thank you all for watching. I hope you found the review helpful, especially the VRM part. If you guys want me to go more in depth about VRM analysis and what they actually mean, let me know. If you enjoyed the video, consider checking out the rest of the channel and subscribing to see more videos like this one. I'll catch you in the next one.